trial and error. Reply. The method of trial and error is a method of eliminating false theories by observation statements, and the justification for this is the purely logical relationship of deducibility, which allows us to assert the falsity of universal statements if we accept the truth of singular ones. Another question sometimes asked is this: why is it reasonable to prefer non-falsified statements to falsified ones? To this question, some involved answers have been produced, for example, pragmatic answers. But from a pragmatic point of view, the question does not arise, since false theories often serve well enough. Most formulae used in engineering or navigation are known to be false, although they may be excellent approximations and easy to handle, and they are used with confidence by people who know them to be false. The only correct answer is the straightforward one, because we search for truth even though we can never be sure we have found it, and because the falsified theories are known or believed to be false, while the non-falsified theories may still be true. Besides, we do not prefer every non-falsified theory, only one which, in the light of criticism, appears to be better than its competitors, which solves our problems, which is well tested, and of which we think, or rather conjecture or hope, considering other provisionally accepted theories, that it will stand up to further tests. It has also been said that the problem of induction is, why is it reasonable to believe that the future will be like the past? And that a satisfactory answer to this question should make it plain that such a belief is, in fact, reasonable. My reply is that it is reasonable to believe that the future will be very different from the past in many vitally important respects. Admittedly, it is perfectly reasonable to act on the assumption that it will, in many respects, be like the past, and that well-tested laws will continue to hold, since we can have no better assumption to act upon. But it is also reasonable to believe that such a course of action will lead us at times into severe trouble, since some of the laws upon which we now heavily rely may easily prove unreliable. Remember the midnight sun. One might even say that to judge from past experience, and from our general scientific knowledge, the future will not be like the past, in perhaps most of the ways which those have in mind who say that it will. Water will sometimes not quench thirst, and air will choke those who breathe it. An apparent way out is to say that the future will be like the past in the sense that the laws of nature will not change, but this is begging the question. We speak of a law of nature only if we think that we have before us a regularity which does not change, and if we find that it changes, then we shall not. -56. Continue to call it a law of nature. Of course, our search for natural laws indicates that we hope to find them, and that we believe that there are natural laws, but our belief in any particular natural law cannot have a safer basis than our unsuccessful critical attempts to refute it. I think that those who put the problem of induction in terms of the reasonableness of our beliefs are perfectly right if they are dissatisfied with a Humean, or post-Humean, skeptical despair of reason. We must indeed reject the view that a belief in science is as irrational as a belief in primitive magical practices, that both are a matter of accepting a total ideology, a convention or a tradition based on faith. But we must be cautious if we formulate our problem, with Hume, as one of the reasonableness of our beliefs. We should split this problem into three: our old problem of demarcation, or of how to distinguish between science and primitive magic, the problem of the rationality of the scientific or critical procedure, and of the role of observation within it, and lastly the problem of the rationality of our acceptance of theories for scientific and for practical purposes. To all these three problems, solutions have been offered here. One should also be careful not to confuse the problem of the reasonableness of the scientific procedure and the tentative acceptance of the results of this procedure, i.e. the scientific theories, with the problem of the rationality or otherwise of the belief that this procedure will succeed. In practice, in practical scientific research, this belief is no doubt unavoidable and reasonable, there being no better alternative. But the belief is certainly unjustifiable in a theoretical sense, as I have argued in Section B. Moreover, if we could show, on general logical grounds, that the scientific quest is likely to succeed, one could not understand why anything like success has been so rare in the long history of human endeavors to know more about our world. Yet another way of putting the problem of induction is in terms of probability. Let T be the theory and E the evidence. We can ask for PT, E, that is to say, the probability of T, given E. The problem of induction, it is often believed, can then be put thus: construct a calculus of probability which allows us to work out for any theory T what its probability is, relative to any given empirical evidence E, and show that PT, E increases with the accumulation of supporting evidence, and reaches high values, at any rate values greater than. In the logic of scientific discovery, I explained why I think that this approach to the problem is fundamentally mistaken. 23 To make this clear, I introduced there the distinction between probability and degree of corroboration or confirmation. The term confirmation has lately been so much used and misused that I have decided to surrender it to the verificationists and to use for my own purposes corroboration only. The term probability is best. Blank 23 LSC Deet C note 5 above CH minus 57. Used in some of the many senses which satisfy the well-known calculus of probability, axiomatized, for example, by Keynes, Jeffries, and myself, but nothing of course depends on the choice of words, as long as we do not assume, uncritically, that degree of corroboration must also be a probability, that is to say, that it must satisfy the calculus of probability. I explained in my book why we are interested in theories with a high degree of corroboration. And I explained why it is a mistake to conclude from this that we are interested in highly probable theories. I pointed out that the probability of a statement or set of statements is always the greater the less the statement says. It is inverse to the content or the deductive power of the statement, and thus to its explanatory power. Accordingly, every interesting and powerful statement must have a low probability, and vice versa, a statement with a high probability will be scientifically uninteresting, because it says little and has no explanatory power. Although we seek theories with a high degree of corroboration, as scientists we do not seek highly probable theories but explanations, that is to say, powerful and improbable theories. 24 The opposite view, that science aims at high probability, is a characteristic development of verificationism. If you find that you cannot verify a theory, or make it certain by induction, you may turn to probability as a kind of ersatz for certainty, in the hope that induction may yield at least that much. I have discussed the two problems of demarcation and induction at some length. Yet since I set out to give you in this lecture a kind of report on the work I have done in this field, I shall have to add, in the form of an appendix, a few words about some other problems on which I have been working between 1934 and 1953. I was led to most of these problems by trying to think out the consequences of the solutions to the two problems of demarcation and induction. But time does not allow me to continue my narrative, and to tell you how my new problems arose out of my old ones. Since I cannot even start a discussion of these further problems now, I shall have to confine my blank 24A definition, added 1950, see also my note, minus 58, self to giving you a bare list of them, with a few explanatory words here and there. But even a bare list may be useful, I think. It may serve to give an idea of the fertility of the approach. It may help to illustrate what our problems look like, and it may show how many there are, and so convince you that there is no need whatever to worry over the question whether philosophical problems exist, or what philosophy is really about. So this list contains, by implication, an apology for my unwillingness to break with the old tradition of trying to solve problems with the help of rational argument, and thus for my unwillingness to participate wholeheartedly in the developments, trends, and drifts of contemporary philosophy. Appendix. Some problems in the philosophy of science. My first three items in this list of additional problems are connected with the calculus of probabilities. 1. The frequency theory of probability. In the logic of scientific discovery, I was interested in developing a consistent theory of probability as it is used in science, which means a statistical or frequency theory of probability. But I also operated there with another concept which I called logical probability. I therefore felt the need for a generalization, for a formal theory of probability which allows different interpretations. A is a theory of the logical probability of a statement relative to any given evidence, including a theory of absolute logical probability, i.e. of the measure of the probability of a statement relative to zero evidence, B as a theory of the probability of an event relative to any given ensemble, or collective, of events. In solving this problem, I obtained a simple theory which allows a number of further interpretations. It may be interpreted as a calculus of contents, or of deductive systems, or as a class calculus Boolean algebra, or as propositional calculus, and also as a calculus of propensities. 25, blank. 25, see my note in mine, log, CIT, commutation, A2PXYZ, is greater than or equal, A3B, and definition probability. Axiom C2 holds, in this form, for the finitist theory only. It may be omitted if we are prepared to put up with a condition such as PY is not equal O in most of the theorems on relative probability. For relative probability, A1B2 and C1C2 is sufficient, B3 is not needed. For absolute probability, A1B3 is necessary and sufficient. Without B3 we cannot, for example, derive the definition of absolute in terms of relative probability, Px equals Px, Y plus nor its weakened corollary X, E, Y, P, Y-O and P-X equals P-X, Y from which B3 results immediately by substituting for P-X, Y its dominions. Thus B3, like all other axioms with the possible exception of C2, expresses part of the intended meaning of the concepts involved, and we must not look upon one as greater than or equal to Px, or one as greater than or equal to Px, Y, which are derivable from B1 with B3, or with C1 and C2, as inessential conventions, as Carnap and others have suggested. Added 1955 to the first proofs of this paper, see also note 31, below. I have since developed an axiom system for relative probability which holds for finite and infinite systems, and in which absolute probability can be defined as in the penultimate formula above. Its axioms are B1, B2, B3, C1, D1, E1, PX, Z is greater than or equal to PXY, Z. If PY, Y does not equal PU, Y then PX, Y plus PX, Y equals PY, Y. PXY, Z equals PX, Y. I have left this minus 59, 2, 3. This problem of a propensity interpretation of probability arose out of my interest in quantum theory. It is usually believed that quantum theory has to be interpreted statistically, and no doubt statistics is essential for its empirical tests. But this is a point where, I believe, the dangers of the testability theory of meaning become clear. Although the tests of the theory are statistical, and although the theory, say, Schrödinger's equation may imply statistical consequences, it need not have a statistical meaning, and one can give examples of objective propensities which are something like generalized forces and of fields of propensities which can be measured by statistical methods without being themselves statistical. See also the last paragraph of chapter 3, below, with note 35. Of statistics in such cases is, in the main, to provide empirical tests of theories which need not be purely statistical, and this raises the question of the reputability of statistical statements, a problem treated, but not to my full satisfaction, in the 1934 edition of my The Logic of Scientific Discovery. I later found, however, that all the elements for constructing a satisfactory solution lay ready for use in that book. Certain examples I had given allow a mathematical characterization of a class of infinite chance like minus 60 sequences which are, in a certain sense, the shortest sequences of their kind. 26A statistical statement may now be said to be testable by comparison with these shortest sequences. It is refuted if the statistical properties of the tested ensembles differ from the statistical properties of the initial sections of these shortest sequences. There are a number of further problems connected with the interpretation of the formalism of a quantum theory. In a chapter of The Logic of Scientific Discovery, I criticized the official interpretation, and I still think that my criticism is valid in all points but one. One example which I used in section 77 is mistaken. But since I wrote that section, Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen have published a thought experiment which can be substituted for my example, although their tendency, which is deterministic, is quite different from mine. Einstein's belief in determinism, which I had occasion to discuss with him, is, I believe, unfounded, and also unfortunate. It robs his criticism of much of its force, and it must be emphasized that much of